and you may become a victim of what I call religious rascals, all in the ministry today. They want title, they want recognition, they want to try to prove they are somebody. When a vessel makes so much noise, you can be sure it is empty. Many times you have to do some things to gain recognition. In reality, you don't need to do those type of a thing. When God confers recognition and his anointing upon you, you don't have to tell us, I am highly anointed. If you are highly anointed, we will know. We will see it. But because you yourself, you never try to develop yourself, then you fall a victim of all these rascals. I've seen so many of them. I mean, somebody was with me in the office yesterday, and the person mentioned the name of a minister that he went to, and I said, what? You went to such a person? He's not a man of God. He's a rascal. Because he had perpetrated so many atrocities, but they got to create some cover-up. They want to talk as if they have God in their pocket. They want to give you that. Listen, don't be deceived. Better develop yourself. Amen? Do what? Develop yourself. Receive power from the Lord Jesus. He wanted to change things, and he called the disciples together. And I always say something. You don't complain, cry, and nag around because of what you do not have. Make the best of what you have. You cannot afford to blame your tools. The initiative belongs to you. Many a times you say, well, I'm not able to achieve this because of this tool. Listen, you can change that tool or find a better tool around. You just must not fail. You cannot afford to give an excuse. I've said it repeatedly. There's no excuse good enough for failure. Jesus Christ had them, 12 of them. Some inclined to fulfill the purpose. One or two inclined to drag him down in the ministry. Oh, some are just there in the ministry for their personal ambition and personal interest. But notwithstanding, he gave them power. Apostle Paul was talking to the Philippian brethren. He said, some people preach Jesus Christ of envy. He said, but anyway, once Jesus Christ is what? Preached. My prayer is that you will not preach and go to hell. Because it is not impossible to be given power and at the same time you see end in hell. Hell is real. And the fact that you are a minister of the gospel or a bishop or is most preeminent, as some people want to call themselves, or a brother or a lay member of a church, it does not mean you cannot go to hell. You can work miracles and see end in hell. I don't know where Judas is today. Because it is not for me to say whether it's in hell or heaven. God could have mercy. I don't understand whether it's in hell or heaven. But one thing I know is that somebody who is a bunch of disappointment, somebody who is a traitor or a betrayer, somebody who commits suicide may not end in heaven. So you should examine yourself. If all those traits are in your life, check it out. The good thing is you can effect a change. You can choose to make it to heaven, irrespective of whatsoever you have done. Before now, hearing this message, and you make up your mind, okay now, I've cheated the devil, I'm making up my mind now, I'm going to heaven. If you have been given power, you don't abuse the power. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus Christ called the 12 disciples together, and he gave them power against unclean spirit to cast out devils and to heal all manner of disease. Good thing is that he didn't say diseases. He said all manner of diseases. I like the old King James Version. The modern version may be very grammatically accurate. But old King James Version is more spiritually accurate than being grammatically correct. Amen. Praise the Lord. Verse 1 says, and when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirit to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles were these. The first, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the publican, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Lebius, whose surname was Thaddeus, Simon, the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not. He gave power to Judas as well. Amen. But he warned them, in that very verse 5, well, you may say it is just literal, or It could be very figurative, which has more meaning than just going to the lands of the people that were not Jews. Because when he says that they should not go to the ways of the Gentiles, in my understanding, the ways of the Gentiles are the ways of the world. So when you are given power, you don't go to the ways of the world. When you are given power, you cannot live like somebody that is of the world anymore. When you are given power, your language must change. Your lifestyle must change. Your values must change. Your interests must change. Power must bring about a change in your life. But if you don't understand what this power is meant for, that is why we talked about the purpose of power in the previous settings. And you need to really get it into yourself that now being empowered, you cannot live the way you were living before. If President Obama will want to chew gum everywhere, he can't be talking to the nation and chewing gum. He can't stay in that very position. Is it wrong to chew gum? No. But there are some things you can do at a moment that will be right, and you do the same thing at another moment, they will crucify you for it. So becoming empowered, you cannot just behave the way you are behaving before. So Judas Iscariot refused to change. He got power. He cast out devils. He did so many good things to people because he was a carrier of the power. But something inherent in him, inordinate ambition, lust, vain imagination, was locked up there inside him. And when the devil is coming, he's looking for your weakness. And he will build on your weakness to destroy you. I pray you not be destroyed by Lucifer in Jesus' name. So watch out. In my own understanding, I start to analyze that the word devil, yes, it could amount to or assume to be a reference to Lucifer. But I have said it to people repeatedly, you cannot see Lucifer face to face, but you can see devil face to face. I believe the person that is sitting next to you is not a devil. If he or she is a devil, God will convert him or her in Jesus' name. A devil is somebody who is an embodiment of Satan or Lucifer. Somebody whose life is already permeated and penetrated by the deeds of the devil, of Lucifer himself. So when you do something that is negative, when you negate the order of God, then you become the devil. I was speaking yesterday at a meeting that devil, so as it were, was made manifest in the person of Peter. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 23 or somewhere there. And Christ said, "Get thee behind me, Satan. You have no part in this business." The Lucifer, Satan and his cohort, they spoke through the mouth of Peter. And listen, when your spirit is corrupted, when there's a defilement in your thinking, then you become a devil. Then you give contrary opinion to the things of God. You become what? A devil. If you bounce back immediately and say, "No, I'm not supposed to do this," then you become back as a child of God. Because Peter stood and he resisted the Lord Jesus about his mission. And Christ said, "Get thee behind me, Satan." You become a devil because you are listening and carrying out the dictates of Satan and his cohorts. So that's why I said that you may not see Satan face to face, but you can what? See devil. Somebody can be a devil in your life. That is an agent of Lucifer, carrying out the deeds of his father. But they will not rule over you in Jesus' name. So you will not be a devil in the mighty name of Jesus. So the antidotes to power, principally it is what? Sin. Sin is the greatest antidote to power. Christ called the disciples together, he gave them power against unclean spirit. In Luke 10, 19, he said again, Luke chapter 10, verse 19, "Behold, I do what? I give unto you power to tread upon serpents, scorpions, and over all the powers of the enemies." And he said nothing, absolutely nothing. No witch, no wizard, no elemental wickedness, no necromancer, no performer of any magic shall be able to in any way harm you. That is a complete package for you as a child of God. But listen, if Jesus Christ prayed for you and you are living in sin, the prayer will not be answered. Jesus, the Messiah, praying for you, that prayer will not be answered. You start to imagine, how can Jesus Christ pray and the prayer will not be answered? God is so holy, too holy to behold iniquity. And Psalm 66 verse 18 says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, God will not hear me. If you are an embodiment of sin, go and read John chapter 17. Jesus prayed for Judas Iscariot, and the prayer refused to be answered because Judas was a thief. So the devil can negate the will of God for your life if you live in sin. I pray you not live in sin, in the mighty name of Jesus. If I don't have anything, like I told you before, you can choose not to pray. You can still be all right. But if you choose not to be holy, you are in danger. I told people, don't worry about prayer. Just what? Live holy. But Pastor, how can I? If you choose to live holy, you will what? You will pray. It is not possible for you to live holy without praying. Because you have chosen to live holy, holiness is one of the attributes of the living God. And like begets like. So when you live holy, you have a burning desire to somebody that looks like you. So you want to talk to him. But people want to pray without living holy. Somebody was sharing with me one of the deeds of the rascals. Listen, there are hundreds or let me say thousands of rascally ministers of the gospel in town today. And they were talking, and the other guy was said, they were reporting this to me. The other man said, okay, has he sent in the money? And he said, no, he has not given the money. He said, well, tell him, nobody's going to be praying if he's not sending you the money. They are prayer contractors. To whom are they praying? They are not living holy. They are professional noisemakers. Don't be deceived by all these gymnastic activities of men. Wherever we cannot see holiness, God is not there. A minister that is evil, it is bad enough for you to be suspected for living an illicit life with another person's wife. It's bad enough, talk less when it is established. When you are doing, and yet, when you see these people, they gallivant from one city to the other, and they tell you something that they want to make, they speak, whether they use any power, I don't know. But I've seen people that I know. I mean, there was a particular case. It was the wife that reported. He said, please, make sure you stop my husband from the ring he was trying to import. A minister of the gospel. God will help you. You better develop yourself. So that you don't say somebody, I'm not saying that it is wrong to lay hands on people. I don't compare people to let me lay hands on them. I'm very even very careful laying hands on people. When I lay hands on people, I want to be my true self that God is covering me with the blood of Jesus. Because you don't even know the person you are dealing with. And I've told you the principle of osmoregulation. The stronger solution what? Draws the weaker solution. Uh-huh. Some good students said they completed it, yes. Amen. Osmosis is the principle or the process by which a stronger solution draws a weaker solution through a semi-permeable membrane. The same thing happens in the realm of the spirit. They can suck you in. Powers of darkness. So you must be vibrant. That's why they look for power. They look for authority, which is not from the Lord Jesus. Don't allow them to try to impress you. They will try, but they will fail in Jesus' name. So he gave the power to them. And some of them betrayed the power. So he prayed for Judas. He prayed also for Peter. He said, hey, Peter, Satan had desired to sift you like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your faith may not shake. I pray the prayer of the Lord for you will be answered in Jesus' name. So it was sin that did not make the prayer to work for Judas. So sin is the greatest antidote to power of God in the life of a person. We'll consider about two cases in the scripture, two personalities in the scripture. The case of Gehazi, the disciple or the steward of Prophet Elisha. If you follow a good man of God, there are two things that may happen to you. And when I say man of God, it could be a woman of God. There are two things that may happen to you. You may catch leprosy or you catch the anointing. It's either one of the two. When you follow a man of God, because number one, every good man of God, every good woman of God is the choice of Lucifer. I've told you repeatedly, Satan and his cohorts, they do not what? They do not make cheap choice. There is none of us here that will be chasing something that is nothing. So you need to, you see a value in something before you start to pursue it. Oh, you are reading to get your first degree, master's, PhD. You just don't want to study something that is of no relevance to humanity. You're looking at so it is because you have value. That's why the devil wants to destroy you. You'll not be destroyed in Jesus' name. So Gehazi was following his master. But material inclination was still deep down inside him. Listen, brethren, what has caused the greatest damage to Christianity today is material inclination. You want to be this, you want to be that, you want to achieve this, you want to achieve that, you want to buy this, you want to buy that. What you don't even need, you want to acquire it. And the Bible says God will supply only your needs. So the moment you start to want to acquire what you don't need, you have already negated the will of God for your life. And whatsoever you need, if you trust God well enough, he will provide them for you in Jesus' name. So Gehazi was with his master. His master was holy. His master was using the power to the glory of God. But Gehazi felt that, if you don't need it, I need it. You can, and they pursued Naaman. And he told lie against his master. How many of us, we use our office to tell lie because people believe that the statement from you amounts to the authority that is conferred on you. There's somebody who is not spoken to by God. You'll say, God is telling me now. And Deuteronomy 18:22. It says, if a man speaks in the name of the Lord and the commandment not to pass that which he has spoken, say the man has spoken presumptuously. Say, men should know what? Be afraid of him. So you start to lose your credibility. If God has not spoken, why do you want to impress anybody? If God has spoken, whatever God says will come to pass. I pray you be the mouthpiece of God in Jesus' name. So Gehazi told lie against his master. And God had to reveal to his master what was going behind the screen. And instead of catching the anointing. Now, Elisha caught double portion of the anointing of Elijah. Now, if Gehazi caught double portion of the anointing of Elisha, he would have been the greatest prophet ever in the history of man. He would have been the greatest. But instead of being inclined on spiritual things, he was inclined on material things. And I'm saying it with all authority. There are many so-called ministers of the gospel today. Their inclination is not spiritual. It's not eternal. It is material and terrestrial. And if it is terrestrial, they may not go beyond this world. Because that is where their mind is. And where your mind is, where your treasure is, that is where your heart will be. So Gehazi's focal point was not about, hey, let me get double portion of the anointing of this my master. He got double portion of leprosy. That will not be your portion. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Then again, when Lucifer gets hold of you, you see, when Gehazi was given that very rod to go there and do what he's supposed to do and let the child rise, if he went in true faith and sincerity, that rod will have achieved the purpose. But he was a vessel, a corrupted, defiled vessel, carrying the mark of the authority and anointing, and it's not going to work. I pray the anointing will work for you in Jesus' name. I said the rod denotes identity, authority, and defense. And because it is your identity, it is the authority conferred on you, it is a proof of the evident defense God had given unto you. When you trivialize it, when you mess up with it, the devil that wants to drag you in the mud, he will make sure he catches you in a way that you cannot deny it. You have seen many ministers of the gospel that had fallen and deranged and disgraced by the devil over the years. And we have seen many, say, another general had fallen. I pray you not fall in Jesus' name. See, this power is there for you to use. Judah in the scripture, when he could not control his passion, his sexual desire, he went to a harlot, an Azum harlot, which was Tamar, the daughter-in-law. He didn't know. And when the question was, okay, pay me now, he put his hand into his pocket. In fact, he didn't even prepare for illicit intention. I don't have any money. Okay, what? But I cannot. No, okay, what can I? I must do this thing today. What can I give you? Look, I pray. Passion will not override reason in your life. When your body is working like a Kawasaki engine, and you say, I can't hold it. You are on your way to hell. And if you do it, the devil will make sure he disgraces you big time. What? And the devil, I'm using Tama now to symbolize the devil. He said, give me the symbol of your authority. Give me the symbol of your power. Give me the symbol of your defense. If you can give me these three things, give me the symbol of your identity. If you give it to me, forget, you can do anything with me. Well, what are you asking for? I will give you. And he quickly gave everything. And after messing up with her, she walked away. When he sent the so-called money, the worth, the value for what he did, the so-called harlot had disappeared. And Tamar was no more there. But Tamar was holding in her hands what? The symbol of identity. Tamar was holding in her hand the symbol of authority. Tamar was holding in her hand the defense of Judah. And when the time came, many are times the rascals want to condemn the righteous. When a rascal tries to condemn the righteous, if the righteous is not standing, they will blackmail you. Many righteous have been blackmailed by some rascals. And because the rascals, they are very vocal. They are noise makers. And Judah became a rascal. And he was talking, go and bring Tamar. We will kill her. Hey! And he thought that will be an avenue, an opportunity to eliminate Tamar. And when Tamar was brought forth, Tamar said, well, it is true. I am pregnant. They say I played wardom in Israel. That is true. But whosoever, listen, your authority, your identification, your NI number, your social security number, your everything have been given to the devil. And now you want to make noise, he will show your identity to the world. See, whosoever owns this rod, whosoever owns this signet, whosoever owns this is the owner of the baby. And Judah said, wow, this lady has been more righteous than I. Lucifer and his cohorts, they do not make cheap choice. Be careful. Emergencies, don't let it overtake your life. You are a candidate for authority. You are a candidate for power. You are supposed to be a true witness that you see it and you declare it and the power is made manifest in your life. But when these things are not the right way, we pay dearly for it. It drags you in the mud. And listen to this. It can take a century to build reputation. Less than the fraction of a second can destroy it. You could have been building the reputation all the years. You could have started very well. Everything had been fantastic. But that very moment that you chose not to be reasonable, you chose not to listen to the voice of reason. And the greatest voice of reason is the voice of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is not argumentative. He ministers unto you, you listen or you don't listen, but if you don't even hear him because he's so still small a voice, and then you come back to the written word, and what does the Bible say? And if that does not work, you have listened to many sermons and teachings, and they do not work, you are on your way to destruction. I want to appeal to you, don't fall a victim. Judah paid big time for it, but thank God for the grace of God. The gift and calling of God, they are without repentance. And he has said, Romans chapter 9, verse 15, that he will have mercy on what? On whom he will have mercy and compassion. Upon whom he will have compassion. I pray God will have compassion on you in the mighty name of Jesus. I have said it repeatedly. Your past is not of a great significance. Your future is what is more important. No matter who you were before, the person you become today in Christ Jesus is more important than anything. Just make up your mind to live for him. And I'm telling you, your life will never remain the same. He will empower you. He will strengthen you. You will not fall a victim. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. So when you look at the life of Gehazi, it was somebody that serious case. Then you look at the life of Judas Iscariot. He received power, he got everything, but material inclination, blood is vision, and he has false confidence in himself because he was building on the fact that the people cannot apprehend Jesus, and if they give him the money, he will go away with the money, and then they will play foolish. But he did not know the game plan of the devil. I mean, Judas was a very clever guy. I mean, somebody stealing from Jesus, and the ministry was still continuing. I don't know, somebody listening to me, stealing from the Lord. You don't pay your tithe, you are a thief. You will take a record of the account of the church and every other thing in the ministry and about your brethren in your department and everything. You cannot be trusted. At your place of work, they can't trust you. And you come to church, you are the one celebrated by the church. The pastor listens to, listen, if you are not careful, you may end like Judas. But I pray you will repent if you are filthy in Jesus' name. So the release of power unto man by Jesus is an expression of the repose confidence. And if you are given a measure of power, you cannot afford to abuse or in any way negate a reposed confidence. I pray you will not play a fool in Jesus' name. Proverbs 25 verse 19. It says confidence in an unfaithful person, man or woman, is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. The confidence that is reposed on you, I pray you not disappoint those who repose confidence on you in Jesus' name. Judas disappointed Jesus. Christ made him a treasurer. I mean, he must have started very well. But the devil knew the weakness in the life of Judas. And he built on his weakness to destroy him. I pray they will not succeed in destroying you in the mighty name of Jesus. So what are the expectations of God concerning us before we go into prayer? God's expectation of us in the avoidance of this antidote to power. What God expects of us that will make us to avoid these things that will not allow this power of God to happen in our life. 1 Thessalonians 5:22. It says you should do what? Abstain, flee, run. If you can fly, fly away from every appearance of evil. Then renew your mind every day. Romans 12:1-2. Renew your mind every day. Give yourself over to the Master as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him. See, this is your reasonable service. And be ye transformed and be renewed in the power of your mind every day of your life. I've told you, don't live one day at a time. Live 1 second at a time to play safe. And if you do this, it shall be well with you in the mighty name of Jesus. So you've got to work it out. You've got to live as a child of the living God. And then your thoughts should be clean. Proverbs 24 verse 9. It says the thought of foolishness is what? Sin. What you think about. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, I think verse 8, that word talks about those things that you ought to think about. What you ought to think about. I pray God will help us in the mighty name of Jesus. Proverbs chapter 14 verse 34. It says righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. You have to avoid sin at all costs. Ephesians 5:27. It says that Christ, he wants to present you unto himself as a glorious church. It says not having spot or wrinkle or any such things, but that you should be holy and without blemish. Now listen to this. I can understand spot and wrinkle. We talk about fornication, adultery, stealing, all this and that. Okay, I can say that is spot. And wrinkle. Okay, anger. When I get angry. All those ones, they are see spots and wrinkle. Or any such things. That one I don't know. Any such things. So which means sin could become so relative. So what is a sin to A? In the presence of God may not be a sin to B. In the presence of God. God says, say to this person, stop. I say, well, if I say it, they will sack me. And you refuse, to God, you have committed sin. Any such things. When we examine ourselves, to present you unto himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle, hey, all those ones are okay. But any such things, that is very, very ambiguous. I believe that is the greatest ambiguity in the scripture. So any such things, anything whatsoever is not pure, whatsoever, anything that in any form that may stain you, may not even make somebody speak well of you. Contrary to, I'm not talking about the satanic people now commending you, no. Any such thing. Examine yourself. Because I believe that you're going to be confined with power tonight. But this antidote to power must be dealt with. I examine myself and I'm not yet good enough. I'm trusting God for a greater height. So I want us to rise tonight. The antidote to power must be dealt with. You are called to be empowered by the Lord.